If you could change one thing about yourself right now, would you? What would you change? Chances are you probably don't have to think too long or hard to come up with something that you'd like to change about yourself. Maybe you wish you were a little thinner, a little taller, a little shorter. Maybe you wish you were more outgoing or more fashionable. Maybe you wish you had better hair or better skin. Whatever it is, pretty much all of us would have to admit that there's something about us that we wish we could change. Well, if that describes you too, then you definitely want to stay tuned for today's episode. In it, we are talking to Heather Creekmore, author of the book Compared to Who? A Proven Path to Improve Your Body Image. Not only is Heather sharing the real reason why Christian women struggle with body image issues, along with a ton of very practical and actionable steps that you can take today to stop dealing with this issue, but she and I are both getting really honest to just share the struggles that we have been through ourselves, things that I haven't really talked about anywhere else. So if you are tired of this never-ending cycle of feeling like you're not good enough, or that if you only had this, whatever it is, that your life would be better, this is one podcast episode that you absolutely will not want to miss. All right, so today we are talking to Heather Creekmore, author of the book Compared to Who? A Proven Path to Improve Your Body Image. Thank you so much, Heather, for agreeing to talk to us today.
I'm so glad to be here.
So we know your book is about body image, so we can assume that this is a topic that is very important to you, and honestly, it's a topic that I am really excited to dive into as well. But can you get us started by just telling us a little bit about your background, why this topic is so important to you, and kind of where you're coming from with this?
Sure. Well, Brittany, I will be honest and tell you that body image is the one thing I never thought I would be talking with anyone about publicly, right? Our body image is a private, personal thing. Like those thoughts that we have about the way we look, like we don't normally share those with anyone. And so, in some ways, it's a miracle that God led me and allowed me the privilege of writing a book on this topic and of speaking to women on this issue to encourage them. But my struggle with body image started when I was in the third grade. I got a new pair of pants. They were pink. I looked down at my legs. I thought, wow, they look big. And then I did what a lot of girls and women do. I went to school that day and I compared the size of my legs to the size of the other little girls in the class. I determined that my legs were bigger and therefore I was fat and I needed to do something about that. So by middle school, I was dieting. By high school, I was in a full-blown eating disorder where I would go for long periods of time without eating and then kind of well, get ravenously hungry and start eating again. And college, I lost my period. So I had this history of disordered eating and really just this all-consuming, nagging feeling that I needed to look better that stayed with me all the time. My thoughts were constantly surrounding, okay, what can I do to lose weight? What can I do to, make myself look better? How can I get my hair better? How can I get my, it was all about body image for me. And really, it was the same through my 20s. And then finally, when I got into my early mid-30s, God showed me that my body image issues weren't about my body. My body image issues were about something else. They were about something going on in my heart. And it was after he showed me that I was really able to find freedom.
So this is a story that I can totally relate to myself. I haven't shared about it a lot on the website. I don't talk about it a lot, but I also totally anorexic in high school and just had those feelings of if I looked a certain way, I would be worth more, or I'm worthless until or unless. But I don't think that this is an issue that is just restricted to those of us who have dealt with eating disorders. Honestly, this is something that so many of us deal with all the time. I know you have some statistics on this. Can you share a little bit of what those statistics are?
Sure. Well, globally, 97% of women are unhappy in some way with the way they look. And then when you pare that down and just look at moms between the ages of, I think it's 30, might be 29 and 55, the number goes to 99%. So a couple years ago, Brittany, I decided to do my own study because I thought Christian women probably don't struggle to the exact same levels that women do at large. And I actually wasn't able to kind of come to any conclusive evidence on that front because most of the women who took my survey ended up being Christian women. But I will tell you that when I looked at Christian women alone, those numbers were the very same, 98, 99%. When you got to the moms, my numbers showed 100% of Christian moms were struggling in some way with the way they looked. Another question I asked was whether or not they compared themselves to others. And again, those numbers were crazy high. We're talking 95% of women are comparing themselves to someone else physically once a week or more.
So those statistics are incredible, mind-blowing that so many of us deal with this issue. Why do you think it is that so many of us, such a high percentage of people, are really struggling with body image?
Well, honestly, Brittany, I mean it's so prevalent. It's everywhere, right? I mean, marketing messages that we see on social media, that we see in magazines, that we see in television commercials, that we see in movies and TV programs. The message everywhere to us is look better and you'll get what you want. Right? I mean, there used to be this attack on the smoking industry, on the tobacco industry, because the messages in smoking ads were, smoke the cigarette and you'll get better, you'll have all these things that you desire, right? And so there's a big outcry about how horrible that was, right? But when it comes to body image and beauty stuff, it's the same messages, and not very many people are screaming about them. So that is a problem. But here's the thing I've realized. Especially for us as Christian women, we can't just blame it on our culture. Okay, we can't just like kind of take the easy way out and say, oh, it's just the culture's fault. I wouldn't struggle if they would start putting heavier women on the cover of magazines and stop airbrushing and stop making Barbie dolls look like Barbie dolls. And actually, that's changed over the last couple years since I even started doing this. So, like, there's all these external things that we want to blame and that are kind of easy targets because they aren't helping us. They're hurting us. But what I believe God showed me was that my body image issues were actually an issue in my heart, that they were actually idolatry issues. And for me, that was odd because I was raised in a Christian home. I w went to Christian schools from 7th grade through grad school. Like, I knew the Bible, I knew the verses, and I knew not to have idols. And so that meant when I went into a Chinese restaurant, I knew to look away from the Buddha statue, and I knew not to bow down to anything inanimate. But that's not really what modern day idolatry is. And so once God showed me how my body image issues had actually become idolatry issues, that's when I was able to find freedom.
So this is really interesting. I absolutely agree that it is an issue of idolatry. This is something that I have thought about a lot myself in the past. But for those people who are listening who haven't thought through this, can you kind of explain what you mean a little bit more? Obviously, we're not bowing down to our beauty magazines. So if it is an issue of idolatry, what does that look like? How do we recognize that? How do we know if we just want to wear makeup to look nice, or if it really is an issue of idolatry?
Well, I think the easiest way for me to explain it, Brittany, is just to tell you a little bit more of my story. You see, I believed that if I was thinner, then I would have all those things that I really thought I desired in life. I thought if I was thinner, then I would have a man, a great man who loved me. I thought if I was thinner, then I would have more friends. I would feel freer, in part freer because I wouldn't have to diet anymore. But I would feel freer. I wouldn't have to worry about what I looked like all the time. I would just be free. I thought I would feel peace. I thought I would feel joy, right? Because who isn't super happy if they have an awesome body? That's just the recipe for joy, right? So I thought I would have all of those things, peace, joy, love, life, freedom, happiness. I thought all of those things would come for me when I had a better body, when I wore a smaller size, when I looked different physically. But the truth was that all of those things, they're never promised to those who are thin, right? And it's interesting now that I interact with women all over the country on this issue, how many women tell me that they have the same story I did in terms of when I lost all the weight, I was probably more depressed than ever. When I finally got to that size that I thought would make me happy, give me the freedom, the peace, the contentment, the joy, I still didn't have it. And I hear women all over the country that tell me the same thing, that they had the same experience. They got to that size and didn't fix it for them. And so that's where the idolatry comes in. The idol is something that we keep chasing, right? Because we're chasing after those things that we crave. And in some ways, it's good that we crave those things, right? I believe that God put it in our hearts to crave love, joy, peace, freedom. Like he put that there because he gave us a craving for something bigger than this world has to offer. He gave us a craving for salvation, a true salvation. And what the body image idol offers us is a false salvation. It's a salvation that says you will be free, you will be transformed once you look different. But that's not what real salvation is. Real salvation comes from Jesus alone.
And I can totally attest to that too in my own life. When I was in high school and when I was anorexic, I've always been thin my entire life. So it really wasn't an issue of needing to lose weight, but still having those feelings of if I was prettier, if I was skinnier, then people would love me more. When I know as a Christian, like we should be going to God for love, but seeing things around me and just somehow getting messages in my head of if I had these things, it would just give me everything.
You know, you're so right, Brittany. You know, another part of my story is I thought that if I could become a fitness instructor, that would prove that I finally had a good enough body. And so that was kind of my level of crazy, if you will. I saw those people that worked in the gyms and I thought, okay, those people have to be free from body image issues because, like, look at them. They're qualified enough to teach other people to exercise. Like, they're some sort of higher level because they really beat their body image issues. And so, when I was in my 20s, I actually went to the trouble of getting certified to teach fitness classes. And it didn't work. I mean, Brittany, I remember my first class teaching a kickboxing class and looking around that class thinking there were women in there that were in better shape than I was, that were better, you know, more fit than I was, that looked better than I did. So it's just funny those ways that we believe that looking better would change something for us. And then when you get there and actually try it, it's like, nope, that didn't work. It didn't give me the satisfaction that really only Jesus can.
Yeah, for me, it was wanting to be a model. I remember when I was in sixth grade, like I had a friend whose older sister did some kind of modeling, and I was like, if I could be a model, then that would prove, like, if I had that title, like, then obviously I would be pretty. So I need to be a model. And I did, like, not impressive at all, like, a little bit, not even worth mentioning. But it doesn't change anything and it doesn't fix anything. So let me ask you, really practically speaking, since we are as Christian women dealing with this issue, and we know the root of the issue is we want to be loved, we want to be accepted, we want to be good enough, how should we meet those needs then, very practically speaking, in a way other than beauty? Because we're Christians, we know we turn to Jesus and he loves us, and all of these messages we all heard through Sunday school the whole way up. But how do we actually do that?
Well, honestly, I'm going to give you some practical things, but I'd say the first thing you have to do is you've got to recognize the idolatry at whatever level it exists in your life. You've got to call it out, name it, and then do what the Bible prescribes. You've got to confess it as sin and repent. And when I go speak to groups of women, I'm always like, yeah, I get to be the speaker that says, you're sinning when you're stressed about your body. And everyone cheers. No one cheers. But then what I show them, what I tell them is that for most of us, body image issues are kind of like this big, okay, most of your audience maybe still carries diaper bags or a big purse. So picture this like big, heavy bag or purse that you have to carry around. And for most of us women, we believe that our body image issues are just this big old heavy bag we've got to carry for the rest of our lives because we're female. We've got to carry around our body image issues. And if body image issues are simply normal girl problems, if they're not sin, if they're just part of being female, then we have no other option to get rid of them than to just carry them around, right? But if we can identify the root of our body image issues as sin, then there's a remedy, right? We can take that big, heavy bag off and really throw it as far as the east is from the west, what God promised us to do with our sins, if we can confess it and repent of it and turn. Now, once you've done that, that's when I believe like our eyes start to open up and we start to see See really the truth from the lies. Now, I'm not going to say that you'll never be tempted by the lies again, because that wouldn't be true, right? I mean, even Jesus was tempted. We continue to be tempted. We're going to continue to be lured into the maybe 5 pounds more would feel better, or 50 pounds more, or whatever your number is. But constantly reminding ourselves, nope, that's an idol. No, I'm not going to serve that idol. Now, how do you know when you've kind of crossed the line? Because sure, we have a responsibility to take care of ourselves, right? I mean, we only get one body in this lifetime. So it's not a all or nothing. It's not a just, well, forget about your body, don't do anything, just, sit on the couch and stop comparing yourself. It's not like that. But how we tell when we've crossed that line from being a good steward of our body to body image idolatry is we really have to look at what's going on in our head and our hearts, and then what's going on with our time and our money. So a good test for an idol in general is to see where you're spending your time and your money, right? An idol is normally going to take up a lot of your time and maybe take up a disproportionate amount of your money. And so for me, what that would have looked like in my 20s is I was probably spending more on clothing every month because I thought clothes could fix my body image issues. If I couldn't lose the weight, then at least I could wear clothes to kind of distract. But I was spending a lot of money on clothes. I was spending a lot of money on, my gym membership and my spa treatments. And I mean, it used to cost me $300 to get my hair done every 6 weeks. I'm embarrassed to admit that. I was single though. I didn't have anyone else to spend money on. But if you looked at what happened with my bank account during those years, it was pretty clear that where my money went was into improving my personal appearance. My time, although this might not have been as obvious to people, but what was going on in my head a lot of the day were thoughts about how I could improve what I look like. So it was consuming that kind of time, and then also time to go get those spa treatments and time to go to the gym and time to go shopping. I mean, that's where I put my energy and focus. And then what was going on in my heart? Well, really, it's when you start to believe that lie that, you know what, Jesus is good, but being thin is really good too, and I need both. Or Jesus is great and all, but happiness and joy, actually, I shouldn't say happiness because that word is used so wrongly now. But contentment and joy will come when I look more like her. And when we start to have those thoughts, then we know that we're not just being a good steward of our body. We've got our priorities out of whack, and body image and beauty have become idols.
For me, one of the tests that I use a lot is when I am thinking an if-then statement. Like, for example, if I were 5 pounds thinner, then I would be happier. Or if I were a model, or if I could learn how to take those Instagram pictures, or, if something, then I would have something. And then really trying to figure out in my head and listen throughout the day, because these thoughts go through our head all the time without us even realizing it. We're just so used to it. But when you can stop and listen, what if then statements are you thinking? If I had a husband, then I would be worth more. Or if my kids were better listeners, that would make me look better. And just what kinds of things are you saying? If I had this, because when you're doing that, you are making that your savior, basically. You're saying, this is what I need. This is what's going to complete me. And that is absolutely the definition of idolatry. So that's what I think about in my own head, if that's helpful for anybody. But another thing I wanted to ask you is how I mentioned a minute ago, we have all of these thoughts in our heads that we're just so used to. Can you actually go through and kind of name and call out some of these thoughts that women listening might be so used to hearing that they don't even really think about it, but that once you call them out on it, they're gonna be like, oh yeah, I think that. Oh yeah, that goes through my head all the time, and that's not biblical.
Thoughts like, I'm worthless, I'm lazy, I have no self-control, I'm not good enough, I should be better, I should be doing better, I'm fat, I'm ugly, no one's gonna love me like this, no one will love me until I look better. My husband wouldn't look at pornography if I looked like her. My husband would love me more if I looked like her, or if I just looked like I did when we got married. Boy, there's so many that the enemy just uses, but I have found. So the lie that started for me in third grade was that your legs are big, like I shared before. And what's been fascinating for me is to see how many women write me and say, yep, that was my lie too. It started for me in elementary school. My legs are big. That was the one I heard. And so it's crazy. He doesn't have a lot of tricks. He uses the same ones over and over again. And if we say them out loud, in fact, if we could come to a place where we're sharing this stuff with our girlfriends, boy, I think we'd find a whole lot more freedom.
Yeah, I've seen that in my own life as well. I went out to dinner with a couple of girlfriends a few weeks ago, and the conversation just turned deep, which is wonderful. I love it when that happens. And then just to get honest and to say, hey, this is what I've been thinking, or this is what I think about myself, or this is what I am feeling, and to see the looks on their faces that they're like, what? No. And it sounds so crazy when you say it out loud, like to say out loud, and this wasn't what we were talking about, but to say out loud, like, oh, I would be worth more if I weighed 5 pounds less, or oh, people would love me more if, I had clearer skin, or whatever it is. Like to say it out loud and to see other people's faces, like you realize, oh my gosh, that's completely ridiculous. Obviously, this doesn't make sense. But when you keep it in your own head to yourself, Satan can just run with it all day long. So you have to get these thoughts out of your head to a trusted friend or, somewhere out, write them out on paper if you don't have anyone you can talk to. So you can kind of look at these things with a, more light on the situation and be like, wow, this is ridiculous. Why am I buying into all of these lies? This is crazy. But anyways, so another thing I wanted to talk about, how do we find the boundary, or how do we figure out what our standards or our goals should be? Because we don't want to go so far to say that, oh, all beauty is bad and we should, not wear makeup at all and we should just, be super plain. Like, we don't want to go that far, but obviously we don't want to go to the other extreme. So how do we find a healthy balance? Is there one set of guidelines that works for everybody, or is there some kind of guidelines we can ask ourselves?
So really, this comes down to the M word that Christian women don't like to talk about because it's always talked about, I would say, out of context, but it's modesty. And I don't mean modesty as like wearing like long sleeves and head coverings and skirts down to your toes. That's not what I mean. What I mean by modesty is the kind of modesty that I believe is actually talked about in the Bible, which is a position of the heart. It's a posture of the heart. And so if our posture of our heart when we get dressed to go to church on Sunday morning is, what can I wear? How can I fix my hair and my makeup to get people to look at me, to think I look nice? And in a way, although we'd never say this out loud, but in a way to kind of worship me, then I would say we've crossed that line. Then our heart is no longer where it should be on this issue, and we're looking to look nice as a way to glorify ourselves. But if our posture on Sunday morning is get dressed, I'm going to church to glorify God, how can I bring glory to Him? That's a good check. For me personally, I know, and I think you and I have talked about this before, even like I know when I go to church on Sunday morning and I'm waiting for someone to compliment me. And I'm not there to worship. Like, my focus is not on Jesus. My focus is on me and my body image idol, really, is what it comes down to. But when I can go and just, I still put on makeup, still do my hair, still, dress nice. But when I can do all those things with a heart posture that's modest, a heart posture that's there to glorify God and not myself, I think that's when I'm doing things the way God designed.
I am so guilty of this too, just hanging out with people. Am I thinking about how I can make myself look good so that people notice me and pay attention to me and think better of me? Or am I going to hang out with people so that I can really invest in their lives and get to know them, and just where the focus is? So before we wrap up today, we have only a few minutes left. I just want to really dive into some very practical tips. What women can do to kind of get this body image issue under control and to get their focus where it belongs. I know that you have a really great analogy that you share about men's magazines. Can you talk about that? And then just what other kind of really practical tips that we can use as women?
Sure. Well, my men's magazines analogy is when I go speak to groups of women, I always ask this question. I say, if your husband has a problem with lust, would you buy him a subscription to Maxim for Christmas? And they all kind of, giggle and are like, no, of course not. That's a ridiculous question. Well, why wouldn't you? Well, you wouldn't because it would neither be, it's two H's, it would neither be healthy nor holy for him, right? It wouldn't be healthy for him personally or for your marriage, and it wouldn't be holy. God's design is not that men are looking at that stuff. It's harmful, and it's not God's best. It's not holiness, right? And so then I turn the question around a little bit, and I ask him, I'm like, okay, if you're looking at stuff, be it shows on Netflix, magazines, TV shows, you name it, whatever you're looking at, is it leading to thoughts that are healthy and holy? The Bible says in Psalms to turn my eyes from worthless things. And one thing that I've recognized in my life is what I consume with my eyes is really important to the condition of my heart. And it's funny, I deal with a lot of women who dieted a lot and are very calorie conscious. Some of these women have disordered eating backgrounds, but a lot of women I deal with are very careful about what they put in their mouth, right? Extremely careful about what they would consume, but not as careful about what they consume with their eyes every day. And so one really practical thing I would suggest is just watching what you're watching. What are you looking at? Is it helpful? If your husband was looking at something unhelpful, you would probably want to put him on a plan to stop doing that because it's hurting your marriage. But are you doing the same thing? Is you looking at these images causing you to have all these body image struggles that are actually hurting your marriage as well? So that would be one thing. Another thing is just to cut out comparing yourself to others. And one analogy that I like to use, and I know you like this analogy, Brittany, so I'll go ahead and share it. But I like to think about the cure for comparison as going on an airplane trip. In an airport, people walk with determination. They walk fast and they walk directly for their gate after they get a snack or two, of course. But how many times in our lives do we look around at what others are doing and we kind of just get distracted? The analogy is that boarding pass that you have, the boarding pass of your life, stamped on it is your purpose, right? And God has given you every single thing you need physically to accomplish His purpose for your life. So you can walk through the so-called airport of life directly headed for your purpose and be free from looking around at all those other gates that aren't going to take you to the destination God has for you to go. And for me, this is going to sound silly, but for me, when I recognized that God's purpose for my life had nothing to do with swimsuit modeling or any kind of modeling at all, I was freer. Because I realized, you know what? Maybe that's why God only made me 5'5" and a half. And I think the last time I weighed 95 pounds was third grade. It freed me to just pursue what it is that He created me to do and recognize that He had given me everything I needed to accomplish His purpose for my life. But He didn't give me what I needed to accomplish what all these other people were accomplishing. So I think cutting out comparison and remembering to radically pursue your purpose is a good way to find freedom too.
This has been so helpful. Thank you so much for all of this that you have shared. Before we go, is there anything else really quick that you want to share?
Well, I would just encourage any woman who's struggling with this issue to talk to someone. That's the next step. You've heard this podcast, you've heard the truth, read my book, and then you'll get a second dose of it and learn a little bit more about where I'm coming from and what my solution recommendation is. But then talk to someone, set yourself up to find freedom. Many times our conversations as women do go to diet and exercise and what diet I'm on and what food I'm cutting out and what exercise plan I'm going to follow. And I think as Christian women, we have a commitment to remind each other of where our value and worth really come from. And instead of just kind of mindlessly engaging in those conversations, because that's what women do, that's what women talk about, I mean, what would it look like to stop that conversation and say, you know what, I struggle with all this stuff too, just like you all do, but I am learning to find my worth and value in Jesus alone. And it's hard in our culture to do that, but that's really what I'm trying to do. Would you guys help me in that? Would you help hold me accountable? Those are the kind of conversations as followers of Christ that we women need to start having with each other. So instead of throwing these cliches at each other, what if we remind each other that our worth and our value are found in Jesus alone? I think that would really transform us as Christian women just really across the nation. I think we would do so much more, accomplish so much more for Christ's kingdom if we weren't hung up with our body image issues and we knew that our value was in Christ alone.
Thank you so much, Heather, for being here today. It was so great talking to you.
Great talking to you too. Thanks for having me.
All right. Well, that about does it for today's podcast episode. If you loved listening in and you are ready to dive even deeper into this subject, I would absolutely encourage you to check out the show notes where you can find a link to Heather's book. It is phenomenal. You will love it, as well as a ton of other links for other resources that can help you. Also, make sure if you have not subscribed to this channel yet that you go ahead and do that. I come back every week with a wealth of interviews, practical tips, encouragement, and all the things that you need to make this Christian walk easier. So I really hope that you will join us. All right, that's it for today. I will talk to you later.